Hey, what's up Blender users, I'm Jonathan, and in today's video I'm gonna walk you through the process of creating this small scale explosion with Manteflow. In this video we're gonna use the Chaos add-on for Blender, but you will also be able to follow along without the add-on. This video is not sponsored or anything, so this will be my honest opinion on this tool. So with everything said and done, let's get straight into the tutorial. Oh, and by the way, if you enjoy my content, consider subscribing because I upload a new video every Saturday. And yeah, let's get started. To start off, we're just gonna delete everything and open the end panel. Because right here, you can see, after you've installed the add-on, that we get this tab right here. I know these are a lot of settings, but we're actually only gonna mess with a few of them. Because I want some dynamic smoke and fire for a small scale explosion, I'm gonna check dynamic smoke and fire. I will also use the 360 ground burst operator for the explosion. What's great about this add-on is the explosion will start on the frame you're on when you click this button. So I want my explosion to start on frame 1. So when you have dynamic smoke and fire selected, press 360 ground burst. You can see that this will add our domain and a emitter. But first, let me save the scene. Okay, one thing that is probably still a bug in this add-on is that once you edit the domain, the cache path is set to a temporary folder on your computer, which is not the same cache folder as for example, manually adding your domain. So I'm just gonna add in a new folder called cache. If we now play this animation, we can see our emitter emitting particles. But I want a few more particles, so I'm gonna select this emitter and go over here to the number and put in 1,000 particles. We could have played around with these settings, but I actually really like the default settings, so I often don't really change them. We can change, for example, the particle start size to a smaller number. So I'm gonna go into the flow source tab, and on the size I'm gonna put in something like 1.8 and hit I again. We could of course do this here, but we then would have to add the emitter again. So now we just have this emitter. I personally want the explosion to have more velocity on the z-axis, so I'm gonna scale this emitter along the z-axis just like this. Now scale it down a little bit so the particles shoot upwards just like this. Once I'm happy with my emitter, I can go into orthographic side view and reposition the domain. So I'm gonna select this, scale it up a bit, just like this, and I'll also scale it on the z-axis, so we have some more room above our emitter. Just like that. The first thing I want to do is enable adaptive domain, because right now you can see that we get a lot of lag when moving around this domain. So after enabling adaptive domain, the viewport feels a lot faster. Oftentimes when you have adaptive domain enabled, you get a really harsh smoke cutoff. You can lower the threshold and up the margin to 24, which is the maximum, to soften out the smoke cutoff, and that way get a more realistic explosion while still maintaining your baking speed. Because this explosion is still small scale but a bit bigger, I'm gonna also add resolution, for example 15. This will just make our explosion seem a bit bigger. Okay, now it's time for the baking process. So I'm gonna put in 256, which I found was a good resolution for these kind of simulations. And now I can just hit bake data. So I only baked to frame 11 because I don't want to wait so long for this tutorial, but we can already see a nice explosion forming. For this explosion, I don't want that high of a strength, so I'm gonna put it to a fourth of its default value, and the up-res factor is gonna stay at 2 for me. This way we still get a nice explosion, but not that high baking times. Okay, now the noise is also baked in, and we can really start to see some nice detail in our fire and smoke. Now comes the shading and rendering. The great thing about this add-on is that it automatically adds a smoke material, also of course with fire. So if we now head over to the shader editor, we can see that we get this nice complex explosion material. But I personally want to change some settings for the smoke. First, let me head over to Cycles, go over to GPU Compute and add in an HDRI. Okay, for this explosion, I'm gonna use a nice overcast HDRI because I found this to give me the best lighting. Just like this. You can now see that the explosion right off the bat looks really good. But I found one thing for the smoke material that gives me some more options. So I just imported the new material, and you can see that we get a lot less smoke. This is because with this material we can now adjust the amount of smoke to get a really thin and small seeming explosion. And still, this is on the thick smoke preset, let's just call it that way, and if we plug in thin smoke we get a lot less smoke as we would get with the other materials. You can also see that the fire is actually the same as in the add-on. I just used a map range node to remap the heat factor output. And yeah, this is the very easy creation process of an explosion with MantaFlow using the Chaos add-on. If you don't want to buy this add-on but play around with this scene, you can find it over on my Patreon page, because I finally took the time and created one. And if you're now interested in this add-on, you can just have a look in the description, where I linked both the YouTube channel of the creator and the Blender Market page. And if you enjoyed this tutorial, then maybe consider liking and subscribing. And we will see us next Saturday, where I will show you how to integrate these explosions into real-life footage. And until then, bye.